During the past 11 years, we've crisscrossed this state while filming, exploring North Carolina. In the process, we've tried to show you the best of North Carolina's wild places and things, and the extreme biodiversity found in few other parts of the temperate world. In past episodes, we've shown you how human actions almost eliminated the once dominant longleaf pine in North Carolina and the Southeast. Forests and savannas that were home to countless unique plants and creatures. We talked about the great American chestnut that was still among the most important and common trees in our mountains and western Piedmont less than 100 years ago, before they disappeared almost completely because of an introduced fungus. There is another problem, however, which may have an even more lasting effect. And that problem can be seen in the landscape plants we have chosen for our yards, businesses, and highways. Is there room for ornamental trees and plants in the Tar Heel State? Absolutely, but in this episode we will demonstrate while removing native vegetation and replacing it almost entirely with plants from other parts of this country and the world is not good for North Carolina. On exploring North Carolina, we believe it is a matter of native intelligence. In this episode, we found two experts from institutions that disagree about most things, except their appreciation of the color blue. Representing a darker shade of blue, at Duke University, one of the great private universities in America, we met with Stephan Bloodworth, director of the Bloomquist Native Plant Collection in the Sarah P. Duke Gardens on the Duke campus in Durham, North Carolina. Representing Tar Heel Blue, from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, one of the great institutions of higher education in the United States, we met with Peter White, director of the North Carolina Botanical Garden. We asked Stephan Bloodworth and Peter White many of the same questions and found these experts from rival institutions, Duke and UNC, to be in agreement when it comes to the importance of native plants in our urban landscapes.
I think of nature as a garden. And by gardening with native plants, we're creating a connection between our backyards, what we do around our homes and in our communities, with what's going out in the wild remnants of nature that North Carolina also has. It tells the value of those wild places too, that we have that connection.
The Bloomquist Garden is definitely kind of a wooded refuge for plants and people alike, where you can see, I think at last count, around 1,100 species of southeastern native plants. But really, it's people come in here often to get away from it all, if you know what I mean. It's very quiet, secluded, lots of bird song and wind in the trees, and when they do, they're become part of a very special native plant experience.
We asked Stephan Bloodworth why, in the Sarah P. Duke Gardens, long known for extraordinary plants from around the world, there is a major section emphasizing the native plants of North Carolina and the Southeast. And we also wanted to know from Peter White why the focus in the North Carolina Botanical Garden is on native plants and not ornamental alien plants.
When I answer questions like that, and when I talk about things like that, I like to go back to kind of the early days of botanical exploration in North America, and people like the Bartrams, John and William Bartram, and André Michaux, who were sent here or were contracted by people in Europe to collect interesting, exotic plant specimens and take them back to Europe, which, you know, was then and still is garden crazy. Our native plants, by and large, probably much the way that the European native plants are at the highlight of the height of European gardening, were kind of a green backdrop to everyday life. You know, that's kind of a phrase I use often, and our native plant species are just that. They're often a green backdrop to everyday life and maybe aren't deemed as unique or special enough to make it into our gardens, when the truth is, you know, you couldn't be farther from the truth when you really get to know them.
I think this is the result of some inertia and momentum from the past. Those plants are available. I think the native plant production and supply will increase if we become informed, if we educate, and if we tell the story of native plants. They'll become more available. So my favorite example of this is Lady Bird Johnson, who visited the North Carolina Botanical Garden back in the 80s. And she and I were driving down the road towards Farington, and she said, looking out the window, she said, "I really admire your North Carolina wildflowers." We were looking at goldenrods and asters and the diversity of those fall plants along the roadside. And she said, "But I want Texas to go on looking like Texas and North Carolina to go on looking like North Carolina." What she was talking about there was the tendency to homogenize, to use the same plants over and over again, whether it's Texas or North Carolina, often without regard to the soil or site or the conditions where they're grown. And as a result, some speak of this era of our human culture as the homogenescene, the making everything similar from one place to another.
We had to ask, why do so many landscapers and homeowners use alien plants instead of native trees, flowers, and shrubs?
Well, I mean, if I'm honest, that's a tricky question to answer, because there are many exotics. Let me play devil's advocate just briefly here. You know, there are many exotic species that we know all too well will thrive. Survive and thrive perfectly well in our southeastern Piedmont climate. The way that I choose to look at it when I encourage people to use native plants more in their landscape, it has to do with the symbiotic relationships that those native plants have with wildlife species of all manner. So this would be birds, primarily birds and insects, but mammals as well, in terms of the very, very subtle issues of timing, bloom time, pollinators arriving when nectar is available, things like that. But the ecosystem benefits that a homeowner and a neighborhood and a region can get from native plant horticulture go so far above and beyond the ornamental value, which is high among our native species, that I try to give that extra weight. I call it the value-added horticulture when you're talking about why choose native plants.
North Carolina has almost 4,000 native species of plants. We're really a hot spot in the world for the temperate zone in terms of native plant diversity. We have a tremendous palette out there, as I've said. The tropics are renowned for their great diversity. Of course, we all know that the high point of all biodiversity, of all diversity of living things, is in the tropics. However, the plants of the tropics are dominantly shrubs and trees and vines, fewer wildflowers. So I claim that North Carolina is the hot spot of wildflower diversity, of native plant wildflower diversity, of the goldenrods and trilliums and violets and asters, many other kinds of plants come to mind. Because the diversity you see in the tropics is all woody plants. It's around you, it's above you, it's throughout that ecosystem, and it's a tremendous number of species, but I think we have more wildflowers.
Are native plants more likely to thrive and survive in North Carolina's varied topography and climate?
The way that I view the ubiquitousness of exotic plant material in our landscapes, and the fact that you can go from here to Denver and see many of the same exotic plant species in cityscapes and along highways, you know, has a lot to do with economies of scale. A lot of the nurseries that a lot of places get their plant material from are regional nurseries, they're national nurseries, they're growing the same plant material and shipping them all over the place. I'm encouraged by the native, local, small, native nursery niche markets that are really coming to the fore in this region.
The great centers of learning in Europe were sending explorers from the 1700s onward all over the world, and they would bring back plants to Europe. We were colonized by Europeans, at least in the first wave, and the result is there's this sort of psychology of bringing things from other parts of the world and not thinking of what you have in your own backyard and what the bounty is around you.
I asked Stephen Bloodworth to explain why we should be proud of the extraordinary variety of plants found within our borders.
This is a subject that's very near and dear to my heart. I'm kind of an urban planner, you know, at heart when I think about things like this. And if I could tell every urban planner what to do, I would make sure that every city found a way to integrate the natural heritage into the branding of every city. I think it would really kind of help municipalities, local governments take pride in the wealth, the natural heritage wealth that they've been given, and use it and as a way to sell that particular area.
Peter White explained that it is not necessary to be a purist. You can mix native and exotics together.
It's not necessary to be a purist about native plants. So there are several lines we could draw between native and alien. The first line is do no harm. That is, there are plenty of alien plants that are non-invasive, that don't pose a threat to the structure and composition and diversity of natural habitats. So the line we can draw is then, okay, there are non-invasive aliens and invasive aliens. At least if we use aliens, let's stick on the non-invasive side. But beyond that, there are positive things you get from the native plants you use. It's not necessary to be a purist, but I think you'll get addicted to the native plants and they'll increase in your yard as a result.
Again, if you already have crepe myrtle, ginkgo, or camellias in your yard, by all means enjoy them. But if you have the opportunity and the space, plant a mix of natives. My wife and I have always enjoyed this Japanese maple, and our kids used to climb it. But over the years, we also planted a good mix of flowers, trees, and shrubs native to this area. Plant native, and the birds and butterflies will thank you.
I ask our experts to describe the relationship between native plants and the animals that depend on them.
So for instance, one of the things that I, you know, talk about in here when I bring children into the garden are trying to get them to think about plants in ways that they don't normally. So for instance, you have some of our charismatic native species like our carnivorous plants. I start off by asking kids, you know, do you take vitamins? Do your parents take vitamins in the morning? And why do you do that? And well, there's a group of plants that need some vitamins because the soil they live in is kind of nutrient poor, and they create their own vitamins by eating bugs. And that draws the kids in and they become intrigued.
Now, if you're gardening with native plants, it also means there are likely going to be other creatures in the landscape that use those plants and depend on them. I think everybody's favorite example are birds and butterflies. So there are plants that are very important and attract butterfly species. Plant the plant, and sooner or later you'll notice butterflies in your yard. There are plants that help birds. The migrating songbirds depend upon high-calorie native fruits as they make their journeys. So the plant diversity in your yard begets an animal diversity around it. And it's just that when we're using native plants, we've got a reservoir of those animals in our landscapes that will then be part of the ecosystem we create.
For those of us who are not plant experts, how can we tell which natives are right for our location?
So we have soil chemistry, we have light conditions, we have moisture conditions, and we have the geography of North Carolina. So if you use all of those four things as a guide, you can find the right plant for a particular home landscaping use. Because it's very important not to work against the ecology of the plant, but work with it. That plant may be sustainable in the wild if it's growing in the right kind of environment. It can be sustainable in your yard if it's growing in the right environment.
We have a suggestion for you. Go to a state park near your home. There are 40 of them across North Carolina. See what's growing there. The mix of native plants for your area. I'm in Umstead State Park, about 5 miles from my home in Raleigh. And on any trail, I can find multiple species of large trees. Smaller trees and shrubs. And a large variety of wildflowers and ferns. In a couple of hundred yards, you can often see 20 to 25 tree species. 6 or 8 oaks. Tulip poplar. Red maple. Sycamore. American holly. Deciduous magnolia. A native blueberry. Each of these plants fills a niche and serves a purpose. Each is connected to other plants and animals in this area. Not all of what you'll find in natural areas is available at native plant nurseries, but many will be, so ask questions. Knowing that in nature there is a great diversity of trees, flowers, and shrubs, why should our yards, businesses, and schools support only a few non-native specimens? So where do you go for advice?
The Bloomquist Native Plant Garden at Duke is fabulous. It's gorgeous, it's diverse in wildflowers, and I don't feel competitive. I feel happy when people are doing the right thing. And I want our garden to be emulated widely. Back at Duke, they got the idea, and that garden also had its origins in the same period as our garden. So I'm not claiming we inspired them, but it's great to have a sibling institution that also has the message.
The information that we provide to the visiting public about how important it is to respect, to get to know, to understand our native plants and to appreciate our natural heritage is important, more important now than it ever has been. And I definitely feel that that we're doing that good work, as well as the North Carolina Botanical Garden and many other botanical gardens in the state and region.
Of all the questions I was able to ask, none was more important than this one. How can plants be of educational importance to young children?
Children are very curious, they're very hands-on, they like to investigate. And I know this was true when I was a boy, but when I see children in the botanical garden, I see them investigating plants and looking at them, but also looking at the birds and butterflies and the worms and the insects that are in that same patch of the garden. And it's that spirit of examining the complexity of the diversity, of realizing what you're looking at. That kind of educational story is very significant to children.
I think it's, I don't want to be preachy, but I think there's what we hear about bugs, what kids hear about bugs in their everyday lives are how bugs are bad. On the way to school in their mom's car, they hear about all the ads for the products that you can use to kill bugs in your yard. And in as much as I can, I try to counter that information by introducing kids to bugs in the garden through ways that that are intriguing to them, that are fascinating to them. We talk about rotting logs as bug hotels. That rotting log was once a plant. In its afterlife, so to speak, that plant is now functioning as an insect hotel, and whenever possible we'll break up little bits of that rotting log and we'll look at the grubs and the beetles in there hanging out, and then we might even see some skinks in there that are kind of burrowing through the rotten log to get to the bugs. And you know how important it is for us to allow kind of nature wherever possible to take its course.
Now that you know the importance of native plants, I want you to think of it this way. Now, I'm not a car guy, but I do know that if I reach in and pull out wires and this blue thing and maybe this belt, this car is not going to work. The system will shut down. It's the same way with your yard. If you take out too many native plants and don't put natives back, or very similar plants, the system does not work.
Does the use of native plants help North Carolina and other states maintain our cultural heritage, our sense of place?
We said earlier that quoting Lady Bird, we'd like North Carolina to go on looking like North Carolina, Texas looking like Texas. But North Carolina is an interesting spot on the map of plant diversity of North America and the world. North Carolina is also not Virginia or South Carolina. It's a unique blend of species for this particular climate, this particular evolutionary history. And just as we have the word Southern as applied to literature or art or to music, there's that same sense of place that can develop from the natural landscape.
So in my house I grew up in, there are these old longleaf pine beams with all little nail holes and knot holes and bug holes in them and stuff like that. And I think that anywhere that you can do that, anywhere that you can kind of draw these parallels between the cultural history in terms of the craftsmanship and the wood and the natural history in terms of this is the plant, you know, speaking of the devil, this is that plant right here growing, and it'll reach 100 feet tall, and it's a beautiful stately tree, and it's been here for, you know, millions of years in this part of the world. And it's those stories that I think really give weight and real gravitas to anything that you do or design or build, any connection like that that you can have to the cultural history of the place and the natural history is all to the good.
I ask our friends and experts why it is important to their universities and to each of us that we maintain native plants in our yards, businesses, and along our highways.
The importance of botanic gardens as the arbiters of this sort of information has never been more important, and the need to get that message out has never been as urgent as it is now.
So let's think of gardening as a sustainable exercise. Let's work with the native plants, and let's get the right conditions of soil, water, light, and other factors so that we're working with ecology rather than against it. So that makes it a story about better living generally between humans and nature, and it makes it a story about sustainability, which is one of the big issues of our time.
And now you have it. Duke and UNC agree on something important to all of us. And we hope you'll agree that planting native around our houses, our places of work, and along our highways is the intelligent thing to do. And I learned this while exploring North Carolina.